I think we're going now. I think this is recording. hello, everyone. Welcome back to another part of Apologetics that we're going to be talking about. The first part of this particular series. So let me just start over. I have designed this course to be a one-week thing, and we move on. So last week was the teleological argument, and we moved on. So we're not talking about that anymore. But this week, we're going to be talking about the problem of evil. The next week, we're also going to be talking about the problem of evil. I think it's important to take 2 weeks on this because it's such an important problem for most Christians to reconcile with their faith. So I'm gonna take some time on this one because it really matters. So let's just get started. So to address the problem of evil, we must first understand who God is. And we're going to do that by learning about the incommunicable attributes and the communicable attributes of God. This section focuses on the incommunicable. But if you want me to do a video about these attributes, I would love to, because they're one, confusing, and two, they sort of shape your view of how God is in a different way. It's very theologically deep, and it's really interesting to learn. So if you want to know any of that, drop a comment down below. I'm sure this will be on Facebook, but if you want to, drop a comment down below, and I definitely will get to that, because this is something that I really like talking about, and it sort of shapes your view on God a little differently, which is not a bad thing to learn about God in that way. So God has both communicable and incommunicable attributes. That's a tough word. So let's discuss the incommunicable attributes first. So I just want to say before we move on, God's attributes are not literally different aspects of God's essence, but various descriptions of God's unified being. So this does not mean that all of God's attributes are really the same. And as we'll learn in the doctrine of simplicity and stuff like that, you'll start to understand what I'm saying there. But just to preface that. So this week while I was studying, I've been reading a lot of Gregory of Nyssa. There's a storm, so sorry about that. I can't control that. So I've been reading a lot of Gregory of Nyssa, which if you remember from my church history portion on Wednesday nights, he's a Cappadocian father. So it's pretty cool. But he wrote a book on the Holy Trinity and of the Godhead of the Holy Spirit, which is a pretty cool book to read in that time period of which he's writing. So if you want to check that book out, make sure you definitely do. It's a really good book. But the quote says, "For all the divine attributes, whether named or conceived, are of like rank with one another." So to get an example of this, God's sovereignty and justice, with their both attributes, are never greater than his love, nor his love greater than his sovereignty and justice. So one isn't greater than the other. So while God is love, God is also sovereign and just in that. So there, again, I think I prefaced this earlier, but there are multiple incommunicable attributes that I would like to hit on, but I hit on these two that I think are most important in determining what role does God include, or what role does God play in the problem of evil. So I think it's important to discuss simplicity and aseity. And I know these words are, you don't know what these mean, so I'm going to help you out. So the doctrine of simplicity, it doesn't mean that God is simple. He's certainly not. His gospel sure is, though. There are things about God that we can understand, but God himself is incomprehensible to the human mind. We don't understand what it is to be infinite or eternal. It's just something that humans just don't have the ability to understand. So simple means undivided and invisible, not made up of different things. So for example, a jacket is made out of wool, and that's it. That's only it. But a jacket could also be composed out of multiple types of fabric, and that's not simple. So again, because that's a little, I don't know, that was weird, but just felt weird saying that. So let me just say that again. So simplicity with God, simple means undivided and indivisible, not made up of different things. And I gave an example. So a jacket is made out of wool, and that's it. That's a simple fabric. It's just wool. That's it. But a jacket could also be made out of polyester and, you know, other fabric like that. And that's multiple types of fabric. It's not simple. So in this, we know that God is pure spirit. Therefore, he's not made up of parts. We are made up of parts. We have bones, muscles, all these things. God is spirit. All the actions of God are determined by the unity of his simple being. And that's all that simplicity is. It's that God is not made up of parts like us. This is another doctrine, but it plays into it. God doesn't have physical hands that he reaches out with. Certainly the body of Christ does. As we learned in church history, the body of Christ is, we know it as a hypostatic union, which means that God is divine and human at the same time. So that part of God, which God is not made up of parts, but the Trinity itself, with the Father, the Son, the Spirit, as we know over my discussions of church history, it's all the same essence. So it's not made up of parts. So getting to the next doctrine of aseity, the word is Latin for from himselfness. So again, from himselfness. It's a little weird because it's Latin and, you know, Latin's just weird. But basically, God is independent from his creation, which sounds a little weird, but let me just keep going because, you know, the question arises about God in the Old Testament. Like, wasn't Yahweh deeply engraved in Israel's history? How can God be considered without relation to creation? And I would just like to say that God is not dependent on the world. His not having any necessity, or God doesn't need the world. So God would be who he is without the world. The world needs God. God is free to create and do whatever he wants to do. That's Psalm 115:3 says that God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. He's independent from his creation. But since God entered a covenantal relationship with Israel, and to this day, he holds a relationship with the world through Christ. And another quote that I have from Karl Barth on Church Dogmatics, he says, because God is free from creation, he is free for creation. I think that's sort of important to wrap our minds around that. So God is free from creation. Like, he doesn't need the world. And he's also free for, but he's free for creation, which means that he can create. And he does. And he did. And we're here. but since God entered a covenantal relationship with Israel, as long with us, because of what Christ has done, he is personal, and he's here. So this covenantal relationship is a mutual exchange of oaths and bonds. He's transcendent. So the transcendence of God, let's try to easy this up a little bit. Let's see here. Let me think. So let's see. The transcendent God condescends to bind himself freely to creatures who exhibit utter freedom of his love and the significance of those he created for his own image, which, you know, it's really hard to understand and really hard to soften up this doctrine. So I'd advise to look this up on your own and do your own research about aseity, because I didn't learn about this until college. I didn't learn about that God was completely free from his creation and has no necessity to do anything with us. But he does, and he loves us. And we know this by the cross. So if there's one thing that I would look up on your own and really study on your own, it's this, the doctrine of aseity. It's a really interesting doctrine. My brain just froze there. I couldn't think of it, anything there. But yeah, all this to say, while the goal is to bring up evil, it's important to know that God is good. And what do we mean by that? So as with God's other attributes, goodness, love, and mercy are all exhibited in his works, particularly in his relationship with human beings. So the evidence of that is, I think, the cross. I think that's the best example of this. So next week, we're going to really dig into evil and what it is and what its relation is to God. And if there's a holy, good, and righteous God, why is there evil in the world? Is it up to humans to decide that? It's a really interesting topic, but I felt like knowing these two are going to be helpful in next week. So if this didn't really make sense this week, there's a part two. So yeah, hope you guys enjoyed this, and I've done the best I could here. These doctrines, simplicity and aseity, they're really tough to teach in such a way that is easy for everyone to understand. So I did my best, but I would really encourage to look these two doctrines up and really understand them over the next week or two. If I could recommend a book, I would recommend general book about theology, Pilgrim Theology by Michael Horton. It's a really good book to just read about God and his relation to everything. He goes far as baptism. So yeah, that's all I have for this week though. Feel free to drop comments, because I personally don't use Facebook. But I can go in through the church and reply to comments and give you guys feedback and stuff like that if I need to. And I certainly would love to. So if you would, do that. And yeah, I will see you guys Wednesday.